interest income at about 99 crores was broadly in line with the immediately preceding quarter, slightly above, but about 31% lower than the same quarter last year. But that's got a lot to do with the higher AUM. I did mention that AUM dropped by about 11%, the average AUM dropped by about 16%. So that was one aspect. And second was definitely the fact that in the current quarter, there was whatever growth of NPA was that there was a reversal in terms of income that we had with last time. Any increase in income because the period of moratorium was going on, and then subsequently the Supreme Court judgment was there saying that it cannot be considered as NPA. We were not booking it as, we were not netting it off against the income. We were showing it as a higher provision in the books. And therefore, based on these two, three reasons, the immediately in the same quarter last year, there was a drop of over 31%, and we reported an income of 99 crores in the current quarter. Finance expenses have gone down versus the same quarter last year and also against the immediately preceding quarter. This finance expense of over 39 crores that we have reported is including finance cost on about 350 odd crores of amount that we have drawn from banks to ensure that we meet the minimum requirement of sanction limit, the terms of the sanction limit. And that cost was about 7 odd crores, and that's not been there, and we would not taken that money. The reduction in the cost would have been about 7 crores versus the 39 crores that we have now reported. The net interest income at 60 crores was slightly above the immediately preceding quarter and about 37% lower than the same quarter last year. Operating expenses grew versus the immediately preceding quarter from about 27 crores went to about close to 40 crores. But then that was expected because with things opening up, we getting an opportunity to go out and collect money. Collection agencies were brought in, other outsourced agencies were brought in, which increased the cost. Actually, the main gap between the two would be the increase in the collection cost, which went up by from over 5 crores to close to 15 crores, or just slightly above 15 crores. The loan loss provisioning in the current year, we have booked, current quarter, we have booked about 30.7 crores, so versus about 50 crores that we booked last time, and 38.5 crores that we booked in the same quarter last year. In the loan loss provisioning, because we had a reasonably, I would say, a terrible August, July, after which we saw the NPA numbers coming down and remaining in the month of August and remaining steady in the month of September. The overall NPA provision was, I would say, curtailed at about 20.7 crores. And then subsequently, we thought that it was prudent for us to make additional provisioning of about 10 crores. And therefore, we made an additional provision of 10 crores and therefore booked a total provision of about 30.7 crores. This led to the provision profit before tax being a negative 10.6 crores and after tax negative 8.1 crores. On a half year basis, the total disbursement that we have done is about 446 crores, I would say compares very well with the same quarter last year, same half year last year, where we did only 133 crores. Book is at about 1,981 crores on book, and including off book, it's about 1,992 crores versus the 2,235 that we reported last time. Overall income is at about 197 crores versus 274 crores, but last year's 274 crores, while it is 28% higher, had a lot to do with the higher AUM. And in the last quarter, we had this interest on interest income, which was getting accounted because of the moratorium period. And therefore, that figure was higher. So those were the two reasons. And like I had mentioned, the income reversal on NPA was not actually booked in against the netted off against income, but it was shown separately in the provisioning only. And total finance expenditure did go down by about 21%, down by about from about 100 crores to about 80 crores, and net interest income stood at about 118 crores versus 174 crores. Operating expenses were slightly higher, about 5% on a half yearly basis. From 64 crores, it went to 67 crores. Loan loss provision last time was about 72 crores, now it is 81 crores, including the 10 crores extra additional provision. We have reported a half yearly PBT of negative 30.6 crores and a PAT negative of about 22.8 crores. We are, like I said at the initial stage, that you know, AUM has grown in the first time in the after about 5-6 quarters, and we are fairly confident that it will continue to grow. And with whatever disbursements are happening, in fact, whatever we have seen in the month of October, we are confident that November, December would be even better because we are getting into Diwali and other festive seasons, and things are improving on the ground. So we are fairly confident that it will boost the AUM, which will which will lead to higher interest income, and NPA, we are fairly confident will get contained in this quarter, and we will see some bit of reduction actually happening in the current quarter. I would possibly now hand it over to Madhu for his initial comments before we start hearing from you. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinod. Good noon to all of you once again, and thanks for being in the call with us this today. I'll take through broad numbers in terms of what is happening on the sales and how we have been placed after the second wave of lockdown was over, and then probably we can get into more details through a Q&A session. From two-wheeler industry perspective, as we communicated last time that it would be somewhere close to what it had been in FY21, about 1.5 crore. So we are seeing that happening actually. H1 was about 65 lakh wholesale that happened in the industry. A very positive sign coming from the market in the sense that almost all dealers, all our touch points became active as July ended, and from August onwards, I think it was very good for all of us. August onwards, every month on month, we've been disbursing more than 100 crores, which is a very positive sign. From industry perspective, again, we saw Q2 to be a very good jump from Q1. Definitely not at par with Q2 last year, but there are certain areas in the country in the third and fourth week of September, they have something called Shraddh. So probably because of that, there could be slight dip from Q2 last year. But definitely the signs that we saw in October, especially with the Navratras and then the Dashera, and then as we move into Diwali, we have seen a very positive uptick as far as two-wheeler sales are concerned. And we can see the dealer movement as well, from touch point perspective, how the numbers are moving at each touch point. So from industry perspective, very positive Q2, and we are hoping that Q3 would be as good as it could be, as far as Diwali and Dhamteras, these festivals are concerned. I mean, this week itself, it would, start showing up. We saw a very good uptick in East, during the Puja season in the month of September. That is another positive point for us in the sense that we went in the East in a big way, and that really helped us as far as Q2 is concerned. We hope that with Diwali, all these non-South areas, non-Kerala areas across the country should do very well. From touch point perspective, as on July, we started moving very aggressively across the country wherever we were active. Close to 70-75% of the touch points we are active now. And as we go forward, and Vinod mentioned in his initial comment that a lot of fear related to COVID is now not there, and I believe that we should be in all our touch points by mid of November, and as we close December, I think we should be active 100% of all our touch points. Right now we are at around 75-80% which is a big movement as far as Q1 to Q2 is concerned. From collection perspective also, because we were able to move physically and do a lot of collections, there had been very good improvement in collection efficiencies, especially from lower bucket. The collection efficiencies are at what it was before wave two, and include, you know, there are certain areas which is doing at pre-COVID level. So we are seeing a very positive trend as far as collection efficiencies in each bucket is concerned. NPAs, we could contain that, at least the incremental NPA, we could arrest that as far as Q2 is concerned. And as we get into Q3, and Vinod mentioned that as well, that we should start reducing our NPA from absolute term basis. So this is the overall picture from my side on a broad level, but we can get into more details into numbers, and if there are more questions, we can dwell deep into certain numbers that you wish us to take us you through. So over to Vidhi, if you can open up for Q&A.
Sure, sir. Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may enter star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may enter star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Sarvesh Gupta from Maximal Capital. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, first thing on the numbers, so you have sold some repossessed vehicles. So against your average, ticket size per loan, how much are you able to recover when you are selling these repossessed vehicles?
The average recovery is around 50% of the amount due from the customer.
So if a loan of 50,000 has been given on an average, you are able to recover 25,000 rupees.
If the amount outstanding is 50,000, because let us assume, hope and pray that it doesn't happen in the first month itself. It happens over a period of time. So let us say if we've been given a loan of 75,000, he has paid, let us say 20,000 to 25,000, and then subsequently the vehicle is repossessed because it doesn't continue to pay you. And at that time, our average outstanding that we both we have when the vehicle is repossessed on an average is around 35,000. So the average loss that we suffer is about 50%, 50 to 52% is the average loss.
No, 75,000, he has paid 20,000, so that is 55,000. Now, if you are saying you are able to recover 35,000, the loss is not 50%, right?
No, the loss will be calculated as a percentage of whatever is the due at that point of time.
Yeah, so the loss due is 55,000, right?
Yeah, so if it is 55,000, the vehicle would be of that quality. So we might end up collecting about 25,000 to 28,000 or 30,000.
Okay. So understood. So that is 50%. Now, in how many cases, when you want repossession, you are able to actually physically do the job? Because in many cases, something else might be happening, like a fraud, or like the customer not being reachable, or the vehicle not being. If you are not able to repossess it because of a variety of reasons, right? So, in how many percentage of cases where you want to repossess and you are able to repossess?
Vehicle repossession is normally looked upon as a nuclear option. If there are no other way to collect the money from the person, then the vehicle is repossessed. So, that's not the first option we exercise, because we give a reasonably long rope to the customer, because obviously, once the vehicle is repossessed, the responsibility of everybody ends and only the legal person has to then start the working. So we are not interested in that. So we give sufficiently long rope to the customer to pay. And then
what is the policy around that? How long rope can you give? Like 90 days is the DPA, is NPA. After that, how many more days can it be given?
No, we normally go, we will do, everything depends on the attitude of the customer. There are times when we go even up to 9 months. If that's answers your question.
Because so I'll let me pitch in, Sarvesh. Vinod mentioned that repossession is not the first option we use for the simple reason that as a group we believe that customer engagement is very important and mostly customer being in tier 3 tier 4 centers and cash transactions high, it is worthwhile to connect with customer and do all possible activities to collect the money, and generally the success rate in that is higher compared to repossessing and selling, where you incur a 50% loss on sale. Okay, so the repossession, we don't have a very watertight policy that this is when you repossess. So our team, so we have our internal team as well who does the collection, they review. So for every case we have feedback, what is customer saying, whether he's reachable, not reachable. You rightly mentioned the vehicle is skipped or customers. So we have those feedback, and basis that then the respective, the regional managers or the state heads, they decide which are the vehicles we are going to repossess. Average, we repossess close to 1,000, two-wheelers per month. And that is after a proper scrutiny by the collection team. Okay, this is the case where we are not going to get money, so we should repossess.
Yes, yes. No, no, sir, that is understandable. Of course, you will give a long rope and everything. Now, between 3 to 9 months when the account is NPA, the question is very simple that, let's say, once you decide that this customer is not going to pay, right, you're not able to collect it from whatever means, whether be it carrot or stick, you are not able to collect, then in what percentage of cases, as per your experience, you are able to repossess, where you want to repossess but you are able to repossess? What is that ratio?
Okay, that could be I think most of the cases we are able to repossess. The skip, the point that you're mentioning, whether the cases are skip or customer not reachable, the percentage could be very low.
Okay, so does that mean that in case you want to repossess this 20% of your book which has gone bad, you will be able to collect 10%? Is that the right assumption? Or because what I was trying to arrive is that what's your maximum losses because of this?
So actually, what we mentioned, 5% loss on sale is average. Average in the sense there would be a lot of vehicles where we'll recover sometimes.
Yeah, of course, average figure only, sir. I'm talking about average figure only. Yeah. On an average, you feel that you will be able to recover 50% of outstanding if you were to repossess the vehicles after giving sufficient due time and consideration as per case to case, right?
See, mathematically fine, but in this 90 plus cases, we'll have many cases where the pause would be, let's say, 10% of the loan amount or 20% of the loan amount which customer is gradually paying. Okay, so all of them may not end up into repossession or loss.
Of course.
Okay, so what happens is once the customer's pause is reaching, let's say, 20%, 30% of his overall loan value, and when they are paying one or two installments due to whatever difficulty they are facing, we are also comfortable in the sense that because cost is less, I can repossess any day and, I would not incur the loss. Okay.
Understood, sir. But ultimately, what you are telling me that when you want to repossess after giving sufficient time, if you want to repossess, you are able to repossess the vehicles, and these vehicles are not sort of going out of your hand only.
Yes.
Okay. So that is one. Second thing which was very surprising in this quarter is that, this quarter we were expecting your gross NPA, I'm not talking about percentage terms, absolute amount should have gone down. That's been the case everywhere, even in your competitors, in all NBFCs. So why such a starkly downward performance on the NPA front? Even in this quarter, you were not able to better than the last quarter.
July, we did see a substantial increase in the NPA numbers. It came down from the month of August. In fact, it came down in the month of August. It remains constant or steady in the month of September.
No, sir. From June quarter to September quarter, I think you have been, there is hardly any company which has reported increase in NPA like this continuing trend. Even your auto financiers, two wheelers, they have all reduced the NPA while growing the book. In our case, the reverse has happened.
So the increase happened in the month of July. Okay, if you are comparing Q1 and Q2, it was actually July where half of the July, people could not move out and collect. So I don't know about others, but definitely July was a month where things were not in proper this thing. Movements were restricted. Lot of areas movements were restricted, including Kerala. So that is the thing. I mean, it was not that customers, they were not there or things like that. We could not reach. Lot of areas.
Okay. And most of the due dates are by the 5th of the month, and once it actually slips into 90 plus, then obviously it's a Herculean task pushing it back. So we, even in July itself, there was a lot of pushback which was done. In fact, the rollback which happened from 90 plus to bring it down, in July also it happened, but then the numbers which actually went into the 90 plus bucket on the 5th of July was significantly high. So therefore, that's the reason why in July we did see an increase. But then the team was, I would say, they rallied quickly, and they ensured that in the month of August and again in the month of September, it was first it went down and then they actually contained it at a level. So we are seeing improved performance even in the month of October, and we are confident that with things opening up, with people having more cash in their pocket, and maybe it's a bit to do with the kind of category of customers that we deal with, things are coming back to normal, and we are fairly confident that we would surely see a 115% kind of collection versus the billing that we do, which would mean a lot of collection would be from the previous month overdue. So we are confident that
the expectation for December quarter and March quarter for the gross NPA numbers.
Now let's talk absolute numbers and not the percentages, because percentages will go down because disbursements are there, disbursements are increasing. So in terms of absolute numbers, we are fairly confident that on a much larger book, the NPAs will start going down. I am not saying that it will go down by 30 crores or 50 crores, but then I am saying that you will see that kind of reduction happening, maybe about in terms of absolute numbers, you will see the numbers going down by about 10%. I'm talking absolute numbers again. And percentages will definitely go down because the disbursements are there, and therefore the AUM, which has started going up first time after 6-7 quarters, and that will keep on going up in the coming quarters. So,
10% should... every quarter.
Sir, request you to please come back in the queue.
Sure.
Thank you.
Sarvesh, what we can always do is, we can do a longer call post this call. Maybe we can do a separate call. You can address all your queries.
Sure.
Hello.
Yes, sir. So I have actually pushed him back in the queue. Yes. We have the next question from the line of Rishikesh Oza from Robo Capital. Please go ahead. Rishikesh, your line has been unmuted. Please proceed with your question.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, now you're audible.
Yes, Rishikesh.
Yeah, I was asking, what is our loan book currently?
1992. That was the figure as of end of September.
Okay. And sir, what growth are we looking at for this year and for FY23?
Oh. We are expecting the disbursements to go up. In fact, we hope to be, looking at decent growth in the of AUM in the next couple of quarters. And I would say that we should possibly be at around 2400 crores or something at the end of the year.
2400 at end of year.
2300 to 2400, that range.
Okay, and for FY23, do we continue this run rate?
We would want to possibly respond to that at the end of the next quarter, because we will want to see this run rate continuing, and then we would want to respond to that. So, to permit us time till the end of next quarter. If things improve, definitely that number, that this kind of run rate will continue in the next quarter also.
Okay, okay. And sir, regarding our credit cost, what credit cost are we looking at for this year?
Q1, we had a credit cost of about 11%. This time, including the 10 crores extra provisioning that we did, we have a credit cost of about 7.2%. We see the credit cost coming down on a quarter-on-quarter basis, and we are fairly hopeful that on a full-year basis, it should be in the around 4.5% kind of figure. Last time, I remember telling that it would be around the 3 to 3.5% range, but I see that being slightly higher at about 4.5%.
Okay. And for FY23, sir, are we looking to get back to 2020 levels or even lower than that?
FY23, I am fairly confident if this current momentum sustains, we should be in the range of about 2.5 to 3%. 2.5% is the normal number that we used to have pre-COVID. I believe we should go back to those levels.
Okay, okay. Also, last question, sir, if you could share the slippages data for this quarter and year-on-year and quarter-on-quarter number.
The slippages, the total number of accounts which got slipped in the current quarter was about 27,000 numbers, the accounts, of which about 10,000 returned back to or rolled back to being standard. So that's what has happened in the current quarter. 27,867 and 10,400. Those are the real actual numbers. So from about 140,000 NPA numbers, we went to about 157,000.
Okay, no problem. Okay, got it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, if you have any questions, please enter star and one. Participants are requested to enter star and one to ask questions.
I have a question. So when you said you are targeting some 2300 to 2400 crores of disbursements for the year, and up till now,
ma'am, I said 2300 to 2400 book. I think Rishikesh's question was what would be the book size by the end of the year. I replied to the book size. I said that about 2300 to 2400 crores. Of book is that is
of the OAM. Okay. Sorry. I'm guessing we'll be anticipating some collections also to increase in the second half. And so will we be able to see such a growth happening in AUM despite the higher collections and repayments, the number of disbursements will nullify the collections which are happening?
No, when we are saying that from a 1992 or from 2000 will go to 2300 to 2400, we are definitely saying that the disbursement will outstrip the collection, which is whatever collection is happening, definitely it will be towards improving our overall quality of the portfolio. And with the disbursements increasing, we are confident. Not saying that collections will not happen, therefore the AUM will go up, because that's not the kind of growth we will want. Because then we are actually talking that the quality of the portfolio will be bad. We are not saying that.
Okay.
We said I separately mentioned about the NPA, GNPA will come down there roughly at 10% on a quarter-on-quarter basis.
But, sir, if you can just give an idea actually more on the numbers, you know, like how much of accounts were in NPA by June end, and, you know, how much slippage is on July. And from there, how do we see the numbers now in September? So if you can give those numbers so we can understand how deterioration happened in July and you know how much recovery has happened in the last 2 months.
What I have with me currently are the quarterly numbers, which is what I told Sarvesh, saying that no, it actually went up from about 140 to some 27,000 accounts got added in the current quarter, and subsequently against the 27,000, roughly 10,000 got moved out of NPA. Therefore, the total figure was about 157,000. Month on month figures, I will need to possibly take out. I can possibly give it to you separately, or maybe on a separate call or something.
Sure, sir, no problem. And sir, also with the macro environment still very subdued for two-wheeler sales, and how do we see growth? What strategy do we see applying on the growth that you know we see such disbursements happening?
What do you take it?
Yeah, sure. Thanks. Thanks, Vinod. When we say things are opening up, one of the things what is very critical is there are various other section of the society that need to open. Okay, like let's say schools need to be fully functional, colleges need to be fully functional. And you know, of course, a lot of other things, restaurants and your theaters and other, you know, social activities need to go up, which we are very sure is going up. And two-wheeler is linked to, the shortest piece of commuting to the longest piece of commuting. Now, when all these things, open up, naturally the bounce happens, the sale bounce happens. Now without that, without this, we are at somewhere close to what a normal quarter should have happened, around let's say 40 to 45 lakh per quarter sale that is happening. And once this opens up, which I believe November would be a month where we'll see a significant change in the way people move around and physical movement and physical activity happens, starting with the festive season of Diwali. I think that should set a new benchmark for the sale for whatever happened during last 1.5 years. So we are fairly confident that the industry sales would pick up as people move around, and that is where our confidence comes. For example, I mentioned about our touch points, which we month on month we have increased our touch points. Then we had very clearly identified in the beginning of the year that about we are right now operational at about 250 districts across the country. We have clearly identified which are the districts and counters where we'll consolidate our position. Not that we lost the counter, but where we used to have very high degree of business, but due to COVID it went down. We'll focus there, consolidate that position. We have identified growth areas as well. Plus all the expansion that we said we'll go slow, that we'll open up from Q3 onwards. So all these things taken together would ensure our distribution network is fully calibrated, and then we are there across all the counters where we were there, and also expand into new areas. So distribution network is taken care through this, allowing all these physical movements. Industry opens up, school, colleges and lot of other things that would further give us a sale. Then third and most important thing is from the marketing strategy. We were very active in all the festive seasons. Very actively we have pursued our marketing initiatives, from various campaigns, physical campaign, digital campaigns, and then southern states we involved into radio campaigns. So that activity had continued without any stop on that. So from all perspective, in the sense that whether you are there in the distribution piece, whether you are there in the go-to-market activity, and whether you are there in the sales promo, we had been very active in this, and during the last 3-4 months, it has given us huge rewards. So from number perspective, we are really not worried. From market share perspective, we have seen our market share really improving from let's say approximately last time we were below 1% as far as Q1 is concerned against the total industry volume. We are at around 1.4% from retail sale perspective. And from finance perspective, we were at around 2.4%. We are at around 3.9%. So we are seeing significant inroads into all the areas where we said these are our consolidation areas, these are growth areas. We have made significant progress there. So we are fairly confident, you know, as the dealer numbers move up, as the demand and customer walk-in improves, and more you know, sectors open up, we should be having the first right of you know, rejection of these cases, in the sense that we should be the counter where we get the case first and then it goes to elsewhere. So we are very confident that we should be able to maintain a better run rate than it was before.
Sure, sir. That's helpful. And sir, lastly, on hard bucket collection, so this year quarter we saw the numbers improving. So can you please explain how did the collections come from the hard bucket? What strategy did we see, and you know, how do we see that going ahead?
So there are certain states where we have a separate team for the lower bucket, separate team for the hard bucket, separate team. So there is a very clear-cut focus there. Then we also organize a lot of collection mailers, whereby through the notices and through the communication with the customer, we bring them to the negotiation table. They come to our offices wherever we call them, whether it can be a collection agency's office or our own office or our Muthoot FinCorp branch. We call them, negotiate there. We did close to 150 collection mailers in the month of September. We saw a very good response there. You know, during the course of this call, we were mentioning that we believe that customer engagement is very important. That's what we are trying to do, because there is no fixed formula that, you know, do ABC and you'll get, you know, these numbers. It is not like that. Need to engage with customer. These were difficult times for everyone, including our customers. So we believe that, you know, if they need some extra time, fine. But, you know, meet them, understand whether they are there or not. Identify clearly, customer is traceable, vehicle is traceable, reach a understanding that he makes the payment partially or, you know, breaks it into two or three, like that. So basically, across the board, we have kind of engage with customer in a very positive way. We have been able to meet customers regularly. That is the key. Unlike just giving it to collection agencies and, you know, drive for either repossession or collection, we did not do that. Of course, that is there. Collection plus repossession is there. But between that, there are a lot of things that we are doing. And basically engaging with the customer. Secondly, with our, you know, Muthoot FinCorp branches, a lot of customers go to branch, inquire and pay there. So there are customers in 90 plus who would voluntarily come and make the payment. That is also there. So as we go forward, we are going to intensify our, you know, if you want to know the sir, we are going to intensify our collection mailers. That is how more and more customers would engage. And I know that if I repossess the vehicle today, I'll incur a huge loss. So I would rather talk to customer, help him out in the difficult time, collect as much money as possible, and reduce my pause against that asset. So this is what we are, you know, on a broader way we are doing. Vinod, if you'd like to add something on this.
I think, Madhu, you have covered everything, but
Ma'am, you rightly said that the collection in the quarter on the harder bucket has been significantly higher than what we have seen in the five quarters before that. I said about 9% of the total collection was in the harder bucket. And we see these numbers going up as we get into the third quarter and again in the fourth quarter. So the intention is to ensure that we come out of, we reduce our absolute numbers in terms of GNPA. And this is where I said that we see a 10% kind of reduction likely to happen in the third and the fourth quarter. And we are fairly confident that this will happen. And the strategies that the team has in place and the buoyancy that one is seeing on the ground makes us all confident that whatever we are hoping and praying will happen, will actually happen.
Got it. And lastly, sir, from almost 1,57,000 accounts, how many customers have not paid a single EMI yet after COVID?
I will possibly put it differently. I will say that roughly about out of the 157,000 customers, there are about 30,000 of customers who have paid something in the, may not be one full EMI, but some, they have paid something, which, but they have not paid enough to move out of NPA. Let us say some five installments are outstanding. The person would have possibly paid one installment or one and a half installment. So, in fact, in the presentation that we uploaded, we have said that the amount collected is roughly about 7.16 crores from these kind of accounts. And that figure is spread over close to 30,000 customers. And they would have also paid. Now, the number of people who have not paid post the COVID would be a separate exercise. We can possibly share that with you separately.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, if you have any questions, please enter star and one. The next question is from the line of Sarvesh Gupta from Maximal Capital. Please go ahead.
Sir, on this 10% reduction on NPA, so you are talking about 10% reduction in Q3 and then further 10% reduction in Q4 on the absolute gross NPA pool.
So we are talking about roughly a close to about 300 odd crores by the 310 crores by the end of the year.
Okay, understood. And secondly, I had one general question. Maybe Madhu can answer this. Is we are also seeing a huge disruption in two wheeler space by the EVs right now. For example, Ola has plans of selling whatever 2 million vehicles and this that. So companies are coming up with a huge plan to sort of disrupt the two-wheeler market. And so what is the role of financiers like you in that EV game plan? Because if that were to become a significant share of this space, and given that a lot of these startups have the propensity to not be averse of losing money, they can even finance these vehicles on their own, or they can set up their own dealerships rather than going through third-party dealerships. So how is that space evolving, and how do you see your role in that sort of a space?
See, I can divide your question into two. One, that what kind of strategy maybe EV OEMs are doing, and then the second piece is what would happen to the financiers, okay? From EV OEM perspective, I think one of the key things would be how they set up the dealership. Maybe they can sell through a platform or online or whatever it is, but putting up a dealership network and competing with the current OEMs is a big task, okay? So any OEM, manufacturer who is into cars or commercial vehicles or two-wheelers, any vehicle-related OEM, the biggest challenge is the distribution, okay? Because it involves a lot of investment by the dealers and, plus match the standards of services. So it's a big investment, which is a kind of, entry barrier for you know, people to come and just, you know, manufacture vehicle and sell. That's a big entry barrier. From the perspective that how much EV is going to replace the, you know, the combustion engine two-wheelers, it's difficult to predict right now because we need to look at the price point. Okay, price point one, second, the charging capabilities, and third and most important is about the battery, which a lot of research is happening, how the battery efficiency can be improved, and lot of activities happening on that front. I would focus on the price point because other two things are more of infrastructure related issues, which of course this OEM need to address if they have to be, you know, successful. Price point right now, the vehicles that has been launched are on a very high price segment, and given our two-wheeler customers who are very price sensitive, I think that is where key challenge would come in EV. But we have seen the way Hero Electric or you know, many other OEMs, they have come with segments where they can compete with the you know, current market. So that price range is where the game would be, and that's where the financials come into play, because evaluating that segment of customer, having the distribution I mentioned about distribution, the kind of reach that finance companies can give is huge. That's the added advantage for the OEMs, in the sense that with financiers' reach, it is easy to sell the vehicle because the finance is available in that area. And I'm not talking about Mumbai and Delhi. I'm talking about tier 3, tier 4 centers, where you know, you may not find many dealers. You'll find sub dealers or brokers operating there. So if financiers are able to provide you that distribution, which is happening currently, and that is where you know, the dependence on finance company happens. With the current relationship, for example, we would be having a database of more than 18 lakh customers, okay, whom we have funded over the years and who have paid as well. So it would be more than 18 lakh. Similarly, a lot of other finance companies has this customer base. So any new company comes to get that kind of base is a challenge, and that is where, you know, the finance companies can contribute to any OEM who comes into the market, and, you know, it's a win-win situation is created. So I think that between the current industry and the new challenge that comes, I think it is more of a partnership model that is going to happen, and all working together would bring the right mix of the winning proposition. And to that extent, you know, MCSL, we had been open in terms of tying up with a lot of companies. One of them publicly available is Hero Electric that we tied up. We are there across like 100 plus dealers. We are operational in about 80 districts, okay, as far as their reach and our reach is concerned, which is common, and we provide them services there. It has started last year, but you know, immediately after the Auto Expo and just after that the COVID hit, you know, first lockdown happened. Now it is improving. I believe that as we go forward, we should be able to have a couple of more OEM partnerships. We are talking to a couple of them who are, you know, in the price range where we want to operate. So this is a electric two wheeler is something which we are very actively and aggressively pursuing. MCSL would be there in this product, and I see that not a formidable threat right now for the other OEMs when the EV comes up. My belief is that it is going to be more of a coexistence rather than competition, for various reasons that I mentioned. And once the technology becomes good, in the sense that batteries become efficient, charging becomes available across, dealerships are there, service capabilities provided across the country, although EV doesn't have much to service besides battery and motor, not much is there in that. Once that happens, I think then the competition would heat up, and I see at least 1.5 years that this should kind of come into play. But as of now, as far as MCSL is concerned, we are very bullish, positive, and this is one of our key projects that we are pursuing.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. As there are no further questions, I now hand the conference over to management for closing comments.
Thanks all of you for being on call with us. We try to present the numbers that we have actually achieved in the last quarter, and I try to address the queries that you actually came up with. Most of, if anybody else who are on the call or Vidhi ma'am, if anybody was not on the call, if anybody has any queries, we'll be more than happy to address any of them. We are, like we said at the beginning of the call, fairly confident about Q3 and even more confident about Q4. And we sincerely hope that we will come back to you at the end of the current quarter when we do the call to discuss about the Q3 financials. We are fairly confident that the numbers will be far, far superior to what we have seen in the second quarter, which was definitely, I would say, an improvement over the first quarter. And we are confident that we will end the year on a high note. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Madhu here. And as we discussed, and Vinod also mentioned, that we are seeing a U-turn in the sense that whatever could have happened, wave 2 is over, and we firmly believe that we should be on the road towards what would have happened in FY20, benchmarking that and then growing further. As we meet in the next quarter, I think we should be able to give a very positive and good result to all of you. But just to assure you that we are there now in full action, and very confident. The confidence level itself is very high, and the recent festive seasons also kind of gave us that confidence. How the OEM grows, how the industry grows is secondary, but as far as MCSL is concerned, and with the with our flagship, that is Muthoot Fincorp Limited, our branches across the country, I think we are very solidly placed, very close to customer, and we should be able to tap each and every two-wheeler customer. We have improved our market share. We are very confident that we'll continue to do that. Thank you all once again, and in advance, Happy Diwali, Happy Dhanteras, Happy Diwali to all of you. God bless. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Antique Stock Broking, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.